Penguin Random House Audio presents Job Therapy, Finding Work That Works for You, by Tessa West, read for you by Kirsten Potter. A note before we begin, please be sure to download the bonus PDF included in this program, which contains quizzes mentioned throughout the book. I dedicate this book to my family, Jay, Maddie, Jack, and Annie. My mom, Vicky, and my brother, Justin, who supported me while I wrote this book, to Quincy Pyatt, whose expertise was invaluable for bringing this book to life, and to my students, whose creativity and dedication inspire me daily, and whose research served as the foundation for most of the ideas in this book. Opening. Most of us, at some point in our lives, will question whether we're on the right career path. For some, that questioning comes after months or even years of going to work in a state of low-level malaise. Nothing dramatic happened at work. There was no oh-shit moment when you woke up in a cold sweat, realizing that you had made a catastrophic mistake by throwing yourself into a high-stress job like corporate law or running your own restaurant. But one day, you realize that you don't recognize the person you've become. The job has changed you, and not for the better. For others, every day feels like a roller coaster, stressed and overwhelmed in one moment, calm and in control in the next. You're standing on a bed of quicksand, and small things, like a snide remark from your boss, are sufficient to make you question your commitment to your profession. But your job is stable, and it took you forever to get here, so you spend your time passively checking out job advertisements rather than actually applying for anything. Our feelings about our careers are as rich and complex as the feelings we have about our relationships with our loved ones. We experience jealousy and resentment, ambivalence and excitement. Yet when it comes to making life-altering choices about these careers, often our feelings aren't what guide our decisions. Instead, the conversation about changing jobs, even among workplace experts, is usually centered around the structural and practical decisions we need to make. Do I want a job that is remote or one that is in person? Should I work for a startup company that I believe in or take a stable but boring job at a well-established place? Most traditional career advice around job unhappiness and job change focuses on practical issues. For job therapy, I decided to take a different approach and focus on people's feelings and their psychological relationship with their career. As a psychology professor at New York University, I'm an expert on interpersonal relationships and communication. As a social scientist, I've studied the language people use in dozens of social contexts, from negotiations at work to interactions between physicians and patients in the doctor's office. Outside the lab, I've applied my expertise in the science of communication to help hundreds of people resolve conflicts in the workplace. My first book, Jerks at Work, applied tried-and-true techniques used in relationship therapy to tension-filled interactions between coworkers and bosses. When I started conducting surveys for this book, asking thousands of working people about their careers and interviewing people struggling with their careers, I noticed two striking things. People who were unhappy at work identified deeper psychological reasons for their unhappiness than the reasons we typically focus on, a lack of interest and burnout. The language people used to describe their feelings about work was similar to the language they used to describe their feelings about their relationship partners. About 2 years ago, when we were all crawling out of the pandemic, I noticed that the conversations I was having with people about work were going in directions I hadn't experienced before. I was talking with an employee who was accused of taking over the work of her coworkers when the conversation quickly turned from a discussion about fraught relationship dynamics to a deeper, unresolved feeling of doing all of the right things to get ahead, but still being passed up for promotions. I spoke to another person who was dealing with a credit-stealing boss. We spent a few minutes answering the question, "How can I protect my ideas?" before she told me, "I don't know if this career still defines me in the way it used to." The people I spoke with would start with ostensibly solvable problems, or at least ones that felt constrained to specific situations and relationships, but would quickly zoom out, revealing big picture problems and the deep psychological struggles they were having with their careers. Something much more was going on with people than bad bosses and salty coworkers, and I could sense it in the language they were using. They weren't just talking about their relationships at work, they were talking about their relationships with their entire careers. I was curious if other workplace experts were observing the same trend, so I checked in with Jackie Brassey, co-leader at the McKinsey Health Institute, researcher, and author. Jackie has her finger on the pulse of workplace changes, and not just the structural ones we're seeing, but the psychological drivers behind them. She told me that although she too has noticed that many people seem unhappy with their jobs and careers, she has sensed that they are struggling to figure out why. There's an ambivalence in the air, she told me. People are torn between their desire for predictability, which is pulling them toward more traditional career paths, and their desire to break free from tradition. Throughout our conversation, she used phrases like a big awakening and an increase in openness to new experiences to describe these trends. Interestingly, our conversation was almost entirely about people's emotions and psychological states. We barely touched upon the structural issues that were dominating conversations among experts at the time, like changes in hybrid work. The other trend I identified was that the language people were using to describe their issues with their jobs and careers sounded a lot like the language they were using to describe their issues with their close relationship partners. Language can be subtle, but it's rich and full of clues about what people are truly grappling with. Statements like, I used to have a better handle on what my boyfriend was thinking and feeling, but now he feels like a black box, indicate a growing sense of psychological distance. Even indirect statements like, my doctor won't make eye contact with me when I'm talking, instead he stares at my chart, can reveal a deep-seated distrust of medical personnel. I've shown in many contexts that the comments we make about our partners can be even better predictors of our future behaviors than what we say when asked what we plan to do. Language can give us a wealth of information about people's states of mind, if you know where to look. The use of language we usually associate with failing romantic relationships, expressions of distrust and ambivalence, for example, were common during my career conversations, which made me realize a deeper shift was going on. Therapy helps us manage all types of relationships. Why not apply it to your relationship with your career? Therapy can work wonders, especially when it's designed to help people not only understand what's driving their thoughts and behaviors, but also develop the tools they need to open the lines of communication between themselves and their potential new partners so they can assess fit before diving into something headfirst. Just as therapy can help people with their relationships with themselves and others, a therapeutic approach to careers can be transformational in helping you figure out why you're unhappy at work so that you can get closer to finding something more fulfilling. We're all in a relationship with our career, and just like in any relationship, we experience emotions that go up and down and that are often the result of deep psychological issues we don't always understand. Job therapy was born out of the idea that unpacking these psychological issues is the first and arguably most important step in discovering happiness at work. It's a new approach to career navigation designed to help you learn new things about yourself and learn new strategies of communication so you leave little of your future career happiness up to chance. To understand career goers, I studied them in a way they haven't been studied before. There are hundreds of studies on the modern career goer, people who are questioning their happiness at work and starting to analyze new opportunities, what they want out of a job, what they're willing to tolerate, how many want to switch careers entirely. The workplace has changed a lot in the last several years, and experts are quick to document how people are adapting to shifting tides. But as I've mentioned, this work doesn't really get at the deep underpinnings of our unhappiness at work. At best, it scratches the surface with concepts like burnout and work-life balance. The questions I had were broader and more psychologically basic. What leads us to de-identify with something we spent decades pursuing? How often and why do we sabotage our own progress at work, volunteering to do things we don't have the time or mental energy for? How much of our inability to get that raise and promotion is about our own shortcomings, like misreading our status at work, and how much is it due to the shortcomings of those around us, like a boss who doesn't have enough status to influence promotion decisions? To get at answers to these questions, I needed to first take a step back to evaluate what makes a person begin questioning their relationship.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.